Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Decades with Joe E. Kramer.
It's 8 o'clock.
This is Ted Poley of Danger, Danger.
This is Lorraine Lewis for the band Femme Fatale.
Hey, this is Kelly Kagan from Night Ranger.
And I am on Decades with Joey Kramer.
You're listening to Joe E. Kramer, Decades.
And you're rocking Decades with my buddy Joey Kramer.
This is where the past comes alive. Hairspray at 8 starts now.
All right, here we go. Saturday night, we got a two-hour spray tonight,
two-hour
edition. Rex Havoc is here.
Yo, what's up?
I don't hear you. Try that one.
Yo, what's up?
There you go, right. 2 hours start right now. We got Danger, Danger, Rock America right here. Hairspray at 8 on the River, 105 and 103.5 around the world, the rivernhpa.com and Decades at JoeyKramer.com. Turn it up.
Changing all the rules. The battle's just begun. Stand up and
How high was your hair? This is Hairspray at 8. This is Decades with Joe E. Kramer.
Back in my old hometown, there were long summer days. Then there were leaves on the ground, and it was too cold to play. The city's colder than cold. It's faceless and gray. And all the dreams that you hold keep slipping away. Slipping away, slipping away. Little by little, let his eyes fill with pain. Yeah, had nothing to lose. You had nothing to say. He's feeling worn out and used and slipping away. Slipping away.
105 and 103.5. That is Junkyard. Slip It Away right here on Hairspray at 8 from 6s, 7s, and 9s.
That's one of my favorite songs on that disc.
I figured it would be. That's why I played it.
It's
only for you, Mr. Havoc. I thought of this during the week, and I said, you know what? I'm going to dedicate this song to you.
Well, you know, there's really not a bad song on that second disc. I was surprised to find out that they were all like veterans of the 70s punk rock scene. And they, decided to switch over to hair metal, which is so non-punk, it's not funny.
But it's helped them make their car payments over the years.
Sure. We'll go with that.
Speaking of which, this is not that was a bad segue, but anyway, Mr. Vinnie Vincent is back in the news.
Oh, Lord. Starting early.
The Rockin' Pod Expo is going to be, I guess, going on in Nashville. Am I right? Nashville?
Mr. Porter, is that correct?
Yeah, I believe.
I figure he's going to be there.
Anyway, Vinnie Vincent has pulled out of the Rockin' Pod Expo. He has said that he wants nothing to do with it. And he released, you can see the whole statement on Facebook, but basically him and this Chris Sinchak, who was, he called a bona fide Vinnie Vincent hater for years. And he said, when he showed himself to me in Atlanta as a fan, I turned the other cheek and agreed to bury my ill feelings towards him. I went as far as extending my good faith and granting him a personal interview for his local podcast show to discuss an in-depth subject matter.
Wait, he's a bona fide Vinnie Vincent hater? I mean, do they get cards that signify that they're bona fide?
He created a, he discovered an ugly truth that he knowingly, with full tactic approval, had been using a disgusting, hurtful, repugnant, and offensive avatar on a message board for years, referring himself as Vinnie's Tupperware assistant. Which he claims was assigned to him as an admin. See, this is the thing. I'm glad Vinny is coming out and doing these things again. He's been missing for years. I think he just texted you now. has been coming out for, and he's doing all these things. But, I mean, who cares? Really? I mean, he's been gone for, 30 years? What did he say?
He wants you to play Burning Bridges because liar, liar. Vinny's back to his old ways.
Who's back to his old ways?
Vinny.
Well, yeah. I mean, just go away. He's coming back. He's capitalizing off all the Kiss things. He's going to do a tour. He's not going to do a tour. If he wants to do a tour, it's going to be his way, which is exactly what everybody has always said about Vinnie Vincent. It's his way or the highway.
I don't think Mr. Simmons will say that about Vinny.
Well, he doesn't like Vinny. Did they get along?
I don't think
nobody gets along with Gene Simmons.
I was going to say, first of all, I don't think anybody gets along with Vinny Vincent, and I know nobody gets along with Gene Simmons.
Well, let me tell you, I am the greatest in the world.
That was a wonderful Mr. Burns impression.
I'm just saying, I'm the greatest. Are all you ready to party? That's my Paul Stanley. I'm just saying, I'll give Vinnie Vincent, who is he? I mean, he's been gone for 30 years. Nobody really cared when he wasn't care. And now he's coming back, and it seems like every time there's something going on, there's a problem. And I don't know. I mean, if he goes on tour or whatever, he's not going to be filling up a 10,000-seat arena to see the Vinnie Vincent invasion.
I think he would struggle to fill the Kirby Center.
They couldn't fill up 10,000 seats when he was Vinnie Vincent back in the 80s.
Now, are you talking about the Mark Slaughter version, or are you talking about the...
version. It doesn't make a difference.
The Fleischman version.
My headphones are going in and out here. Okay. Either way, it doesn't... I mean, this is... So then he goes on attacking this guy.
I don't know.
It is that we who have, even if in the last 30 years you might have said something bad, at least you were mentioning his name, because frankly, nobody was. So if somebody was mentioning his name, whatever it was, and playing his music, then, he should be happy about that. Not start, complaining like he's this hot commodity that everybody wants to book.
Well, all the Kiss people want him because nobody's talked to him for 30 years.
I guess. I don't know.
They all want,
The fact that he looks like Mary Poppins doesn't bother him.
He doesn't look like Mary Poppins. He looks like Mary Poppins' grandmother.
I guess, I don't know. Not that there's anything wrong with that, by the way. All right. We're, of course, going to talk Kiss coming up because they got a big old concert tour that'll be happening starting in January of 2019. Speaking of Mark Slaughter, here's Slaughter desperately. Right here. Here's Brady.
That's it.
Hairspray and lots of it. This is Hairspray at 8 on Decades.
You are my fire, the one desire. Believe when I say that I want.
Tell me why
I never wanna hear.
The River 105 and 103.5. It's Joey Kramer. Rex Havoc is here. That is Steel Panther. And I Want It That Way right here on Hairspray. An 8-2-hour edition tonight.
Yeah, we're just reminiscing. That's the first time I ever heard that song. I was like, you know, they're going to Steel Panther. It's going to be, you know, obscenities and you know, I guess.
Spit
you know,
it out.
References to
well,
body.
That's all they do in
yeah,
every
pretty,
song.
Pretty much.
It's like if you're picturing a family affair with Steel Panther, you're in for a.
And then it was like, wow, they actually played it straight, and they actually did a great job with it. So I mean, yeah.
So Dee Snider has his first solo, well, not first solo album, but since Twisted Sister has gone their separate ways, he has was it For the Love of Metal coming out. That's all I know about it. I haven't heard.
Does it come with a big sticker that says get in, sit down, shut up, and hold on?
I don't. What's that supposed to mean?
It's a House of Hair reference.
Anyway, he has t-shirts and all that stuff. He's getting ready for the. I'm trying to see where the release set is of it, but I think it's coming out in July.
Ooh.
If I remember.
Joey, keep in mind that would make a wonderful birthday present. Just
for
saying.
What? For what?
Just saying. You know,
you want a Dee Snider album?
Why not? It's not like you're going to get me anything else.
I don't know. Dee Snider and Gene Simmons should get together and do a duet. They don't like each other. I understand that. But, I mean, because they're both kind of the same person. They're both like, we're the greatest in the world.
And, you know, they could get Nikki Sixx to play bass on it so that, like, we could get a lot of blood in there, too, you know?
He's Tomorrow's No Concern is his first song that he released, and of course it's a marketing campaign for Dee Snider. He's you know packing every penny he can into this, but he did some type of I don't know if he did a GoFundMe, but of course that's the new thing with all these bands is they're doing a GoFundMe to get their new album coming. Actually, it's called Pledge Music, but Queensryche, they're having a campaign now to raise funds for their next studio album. Now these are rock stars.
No, wait, is this Queensryche or Jeff Tate's Queensryche?
It's Queensryche. I don't know which Queensryche it is. Just says Queensryche have Pledge Music campaign. So it says Queensryche have decided to use Pledge Music to raise funds for their next studio album, which does not currently have a release date. We have been locked in the studio for the last few months, and we are still hard at work crafting the Queensryche album. We always take pride in the music we create, and it is you, the loyal supporters, that have allowed us to grow and evolve as the band. And it just says Queensryche.
Yeah.
It doesn't say which one it is.
I'll pass.
I mean, I never liked Queensryche. I never got them.
There's only two songs.
And I don't understand the whole Pledge Music thing. Make an album. I mean, I know they're expensive to make an album. Most of these guys have their own studios. They record everything on their own. And they go to,
That one I can explain to you, okay? Why would they put up their own money when they could get you to give you the money to do it?
Kiss, I hear, is making a new album, and they're going to do a Pledge Music. I'm kidding. It was a joke.
I,
but, you know, I could see something like that happening.
I want it said for the members of the Kiss Room that are listening.
No, I did not
fire the first shot.
No, that is not a shot. But I'm saying that's something, you know, all the bands are doing. And I wouldn't be surprised if Kiss said, hey, you want us to make an album? You're so interested in us making a brand new album. Well, then, you know what? We're going to do a Pledge Music, put the money up, and we'll make a brand new album.
Because, I don't think it'll ever happen for the simple reason that, Paul Stanley really has no interest in making
Paul Stanley
music.
Has no interest in making any.
You know, and what do you do? An album full of of Tommy Thayer and Gene Simmons songs.
And yeah, and Tommy Thayer played with Black and Blue this, was it last weekend, weekend before?
Uh-huh, that's funny, because Jamie St. James had said never again, but okay.
Yeah, he played, I guess, somebody's wife in the band has cancer, and they were doing a benefit, and Tommy Thayer actually...
So he showed up and said...
Well, no, it was planned. He got on stage, they performed together, so...
Okay, well, I mean...
But I can't see a band like Kiss making a new album. You've got such a catalog. I mean, you're going back 40-some years. What's the point of making new songs, which, let's face it, even if you're the biggest Kiss fan, do we really like the new Kiss music? If you get one good song on an album, you're lucky.
Watch. That's just about every band these days.
I mean, if you want to release something new, release one song. But don't do it and then shove it down our throats in concert.
And that's just about every band these days. They, you know, they'll put out an album with 10 songs, at least 10 songs. You know, well, if you're lucky, 10 songs.
And you'd never get me.
And you get one really, really, really good song. And you get like three or four that are good. Then you get the rest of them like, what did I pay
that's
for?
That's one of the reasons you would never catch me at a Europe concert, because their sound has changed so much over the years. You go to see Europe in concert. I was looking at their playlist on Setlist FM or whatever it's called. And, you know, 14 songs they perform. And I think the only song I really knew on it was the Final Countdown. It was all new stuff. They perform all new stuff. So if you're going to go to see Europe and you think you're going to hear Rock the Night or Carrie or Superstitious, you're going to be very disappointed.
I see. And that's, but at the same token, that's why I have no problem buying a Trickster album if they put out a new one.
But I like Trickster's new music too.
Because their sound stays
the same. You know, I don't know why they got to change.
So.
To prove a point or something, I don't know.
No, it's called, you know, we're 40 years older, we can't hit those notes no more.
I don't get it. It's like progressive rock now, Europe. It doesn't even make sense. All right, we got more decades coming up. We're going to talk about that
they're
Kiss.
From Europe, what do you expect?
We're going to talk about that Kiss tour, which will be kicking off in January. So, did you get another text there?
I think so. Yes.
Who's it from?
It's from Mr. Porter.
And what did Mr. Porter say?
He agrees with my opinion of Mr. Vincent.
Oh, so. See?
I can't tell you what that is on the air, but the initials are DB. You figure
it out. All right,
out.
We got more decades coming up, more Hairspray at 8. 2 hours tonight right here on the River 105 and 103.5. Hang on.
This is Hairspray at 8.
The biggest hits, the river.
keeping it stiff. This is Hairspray at 8 with Joe E. Kramer.
And a John Travolta close. It was very cool. Could you picture if they they had names now and that song came out, there would be so many pictures on the internet of the three of them dressed like in like the John Travolta clothes, the four of them.
I'm sure there were back then. We just never got to see them.
And I'll talk about Kiss first, because then I'll talk about Adrian Vandenberg and his thought on the VIP thing, which I always hate. I never understood. But anyway, Gene Simmons has revealed that Kiss is set to announce a huge 3-year world tour kicking off in January 2019. This is from a Swedish newspaper that interviewed him on June 6th. He described that the glam metal veterans would return in the new year with the most spectacular tour ever. He added that it would also take in all continents. There you go.
So they're going to play it to the Penguins?
So are you going to play I Was Made for Loving You? I would say as a reporter.
They're going to play to the Penguins?
Hey. Kiss Catalog, the company that filed the End of the Road application, is one of the other, is the company that actually wants to trademark that. So people are saying, is it going to be a farewell tour? He said, let me put it bluntly. One day we are going to stop and do the last show. I don't know when that is. I still look stunning in real life.
Yeah, whatever helps you sleep at night, Gene. So we were talking before about Kiss putting out a new album and how nobody wants that. Our mutual friend, you know, the owner of the Kiss Room.
D. Matt Porter,
right. He has a great idea. Kiss should do a bootleg of the month.
You mean like a concert? Well, just go to go to MP3 Millions. You'll see a lot of bootlegs on there.
Man. I have a friend who, well, an acquaintance now, because we haven't talked in years, who has probably 500, maybe 600 Kiss bootlegs.
I'm not getting involved because Gene's going to call the station, and then he's going to sue us.
He can't sue us. We don't own them.
So we're going to talk about this more coming up. There's more pressing.
That's a great idea, though. I mean, because there are people out there. I mean, those people who like the people who collect Grateful Dead stuff.
Yeah, but Grateful Dead let them do that.
You know, but this is Kiss putting it
could
out there.
Could you picture? Because you think Gene would? Sure, do you honestly think Gene would say, "Hey, record my music and put it out there"?
But what I'm saying is, Kiss records. They probably record every show. All right.
Well, they do that. Remember, they used to give those CDs away at the end. I have Kiss Live in Scranton.
I have Kiss Live on the Mountain. I have two different versions of
it. So they did do
that. One came on a really cool flash drive that I have no idea where it is.
Mine were just on blank discs.
No, I missed the flash drive one.
In bigger news.
Yeah. Oh, Lord have mercy.
The new and improved. Here we go. Mr. Matt Porter will like this one.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, His Highness of Hair, the Guru of Glam, the Master of Metal, the Immortal and Immoral, Rex Havoc!
This is Hairspray at 8.
The biggest hits forever.
Never thought our love would last for so long. Time and time and again, you would be gone. Still we kept on hanging on. I guess it's meant to be that your heart still belongs to me. And now it's to the test of time. We survived.
to Mr. Havoc about that we talk and we lose track of time. On the River 105 and 103.5, we're talking a little Kiss. We're talking about Dee Snider. Kiss, the only thing I think what Kiss would do would be very cool is do it a lot of the, like Styx always does. Do one album. Say it's Destroyer tonight. We're going to do Destroyer from beginning to end. And then at the end of the concert, you do a bunch of other songs.
Yeah.
You know, tonight we're going to do Hotter Than Hell from beginning to end. Hotter Than Hell.
That's not a bad idea.
And go, I mean, don't do The Elder. I mean, you don't want people to be comatose, but you want to.
I like The Elder.
I knew you were going to say that. I saw that coming. Is your hair pink, by the way?
Yeah, I did it for Mother's Day.
Then I can. Okay, that's sweet.
Yeah.
It's not all pink, though, is it?
No, it's just a little bit.
Okay.
Starting to fade.
I've actually decided
I'm going to keep it.
I think I'm going to go purple.
I kind of like it. I can't go purple. Well, there's a funny story I'll have to tell you off the air about purple.
All right. Since we're running drastically behind here, I've got to take a break. We've got to play some spots here, commercials, pay the bills. Then we're going to come back with Guns N' Roses.
Oh, it must be bathroom break time.
Yeah, really. I don't know how much of we're going to play, but we're going to get part of it in there. Straight ahead. It's Hairspray at 8, two-hour edition on the River 105, 103.5, live around the world at theriverNEPA.com, 105theriver.net, Decades with JoeyKramer.com, and the Radio Bold app. We will be right back. Hang on.
It's 9 o'clock.
Hi, this is Chip Snuff, and you're listening to Decades.
Hey, everybody, this is Janet Gardner from Vixen, and you are listening to Decades.
Hey, everybody, how you doing? This is Billy Childs from Britney Fox, and you're listening to Decades.
This is where the past comes alive. Hairspray at 8 starts now.
Hey, that's like deja vu playing it again, right? Hairspray at 8, we're doing 2 hours. I call it the 2 hour spray tonight. And Rick Kavik is here. He's stepped out momentarily, but he will be back. Let's get it going, Brittany Fox.
Hey, everybody, how you doing? This is Billy Childs from Brittany Fox, and you're listening to Decades with Joey Kramer.
How high was your hair? This is Hairspray at 8. This is Decades with Joe E. Kramer.
Whiteness from Kix, and you are rocking and rolling with Joey Kramer on Decades.
All right, Kix on Hairspray at 8th, River 105 and 103.5, Body Talk. I'm getting another text. I'm lighting the place up tonight.
Yeah, wow.
So that song, of course, was done by who originally?
That was Kix.
No, but who did it originally?
Originally?
Who wrote it for Kix and actually did their own version of it?
I have no idea.
Nick Gilder.
Really?
Hot Child in the City.
Really?
Yes.
I'll have to go looking for that.
Yeah, he actually has his own version on YouTube, Mike just told me that, but I knew that before.
I'll have to go looking for that.
And this is another thing about Kix, because they're still, you know, somewhat popular, and they have had zero success on any type of chart. And since 1981, going up to 2014... they've only had one, two, three songs enter either the U.S. or U.S. rock chart.
Right.
That's it. They haven't hit anywhere else in the world except for on the U.S. pop singles chart and the U.S. rock singles chart. And the only three songs that hit was Body Talk, which hit 104 in 1983. Now, that's going back. They're calculating that because there was no 104 back then. And Don't Close Your Eyes at number 11 on the pop chart, 16 on the rock chart, And they had one more that hit the rock chart.
It was probably either Cold Blood or Blow My Fuse.
Nope.
Really?
Girl Money.
Oh, that was a great tune.
And here's the
other
thing.
That was a wonderful tune in strip club.
What was their, as far as chart position, their highest charting album, of course, was Blow My Fuse at number 46. What was their next highest charting album?
Probably Cool Kids.
Rock Your Face Off.
Really?
Hit number 49.
Really?
No, obviously charts are different than they were back, you know, in the day. But, yeah, Rock Your Face Off sold nearly 50,000 copies when it was released in 2014.
Yeah, I bought one.
It debuted at number 49.
I want to point out that I actually bought one. Not acquired it any other way. I actually had to go to four different record stores. Kids, those are those records or those big, like, vinyl things that you can, like, play?
Didn't you?
Had to go to four different record stores to find it.
Didn't you actually think of, like, going on Amazon and just typing it in and hitting
place your order? I wanted it right
then. You couldn't wait those extra day or two to get it. You had to have it in your hand right there. You were probably worried it was going to sell out and it wasn't going to be available.
Exactly.
Anymore.
Exactly. I was like, this is, you know, people have waited for this new Kix album for almost 20 years.
I know, and now I get you.
And it's going to sell out. And when I finally got to, I want to say it was the one over on Monday Street. What is that, Sam? I guess I can't say it.
Don't say it. Can't say stuff.
Yeah. But you know, it was, there was like five copies of it, but I couldn't find it anywhere else.
And I know when I had Steve Whiteman on, we talked about Cool Kids. And he was funny about it because the two of us, at one point, we were laughing so hard about it that I had to cut part of it out of the interview because we went on about 10 minutes. I mean,
I know they're not a big fan of that album.
No, he's beyond not a big fan. Like, he hated that album more than it was. He said it was kind of like, you know, one of these, those reality shows that were on, that they put these boys in a band together. He said that's what it was basically for Cool Kids. He said they put us in a studio. They gave us these songs. They said they want us to do this sound. And we went through these ridiculous songs and ridiculous videos. And that's what became Cool Kids. And he's lighthearted about it now, but he hated the album. Cool. I even suggested, why don't you do a concert tour and just do Cool Kids from start to finish? You had your synthesizer there.
And you wonder why he won't return your phone calls.
He returns my phone calls. We had a good time. He was actually a very nice guy.
Steve's a really nice guy.
He was actually a very nice guy. So, all right, we're going to talk about my favorite topic in the world coming up, which is paying to meet your favorite bands.
Oh, dear Gene.
And I have backup, so. Winger right here, Hairspray at 8. It's a two-hour spray tonight.
Come to Hairspray at 8 on Decade.
2-hour edition of Decades and Halloween. I Don't Want to Cry No More, right here on Decades. Halloween rocks.
I was never a big fan.
That's the only song I like, Brenham. That's just about it. They ran the same. Somebody posted on Facebook the other day they went to see Slayer. Now, I'm not getting old. I don't think I don't feel old, but I don't know if I'd be able to handle a Slayer concert. It was noise.
I'd rather listen to Slayer than some of that electronic music that's out there today.
I don't know. It's kind of even. I'd have such a headache walking out of that concert. There's just I like songs that have some type of melodic to them. I mean, they could actually, you know, Slayer songs are all the same. Like that dude from Motorhead.
Don't be dissing the Motorhead,
oh,
man.
Oh, man. Anyway, what I wanted to talk about was my favorite topic, VIP meets.
Here we go.
Now, this is not, I'm not, former Whitesnake and current Vandenberg's Moon Kings guitarist, Adrian Vandenberg, was recently interviewed, and he said, VIP meet and greets, as well as reuniting once again with Whitesnake, is, but you know, he has his thinks about both of them. He wants to get back together with David Coverdale. He said it's always a chance, but more importantly, he's not into selling VIP things. I know it's a good way to make extra money, but to me, it's like you're prostituting out the band for money. If people want to pick a picture with me, it's never been a problem because I still remember standing in the rain for 2 hours waiting for a picture and a photo with one of my heroes, and I know what it feels like when they don't do it. You feel really disappointed. I couldn't agree with him more. Why do you pay money, exuberant amounts of money, to take a picture with a band or a just, you know, an artist? I don't get it.
I don't know.
I don't understand. Somebody explain it to me. How is it worth to go backstage and pay $1,000 to take a picture and talk to the band a little bit? And like, how is that worth? I mean, these guys, they wouldn't be there without the fans. So then in turn, they say, we're only going to meet you if you have the money to shake my hand. You know, I'm sorry. I'm not going to shake your hand unless you give me $1,500. Then I'll shake your hand, take a picture with you, maybe play a couple songs or two backstage. But if you don't have that money, sorry, only the fans who have money could actually meet me.
This is one of those few topics that you and I agree on.
I don't understand it.
I mean, I actually thought this phenomena of the meet and greet was going to go away after the last thing that happened in Florida a couple years ago. You know, because any deranged fan can show up and pay their $1,500 and go backstage and do whatever they want.
I know.
You know?
I don't get it. I don't know how you look a fan in the eye, and I would like some of these artists that do this to look a fan in the eye and say, look it, he could come back. But, you know, although you've bought all of our music through the years and gone through a lot of concerts and, you know, supported us, you can't come back here and talk to us or have us sign anything for you or take a picture. Because if you want that, you're going to have to give me another $2,000. Okay. I'm sorry. This is the way it is. We don't talk to you unless you show us the money. Then we'll talk to you. But by the way, buy our new album.
Well, it's the same thing as
I don't get it.
It's the same thing as your pledge music, you know?
I know, I just don't understand it.
You know, hey, we're your rock star heroes. You know, you love us, you know, you want us to make more music for you. You know, you're the reason that we get to live in these big, huge houses, you know, drive these expensive cars, you know, have these wonderful, exotic looking women, you know, and all these really cool things. But I shouldn't have to put up my money to make my new album.
I believe
me money so that you can,
and the
I
word,
can make my new album.
And the word hero is just thrown out to everybody. You know, a hero is somebody who, you know, is in our military, who dies for our country. You know, you do something for people you don't know. You give your life for some. I'm sorry. A hero is not somebody who plays a guitar or catches a football or shoots a basketball. They're great guys. They're great people. They're people you can even look up to and say, hey, you know, I learned a lot from them. But to consider people heroes, I don't know.
No, I mean, given the the amount of chemical abuses in rock and roll, I won't say role model.
Can't say role model for a lot of them.
But I admire what Nikki Sixx has done.
Admire is different than calling them a hero, though. You can admire somebody and say, hey, I admire what you've done. But when you say, he's my hero, you want to look up to your father, and say they were a hero or an uncle, or like I said, somebody who has done something. These guys haven't done anything for you in your life.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
This is almost as bad as the fishbowl.
Yeah, I know. All right, we got more Hairspray in a two-hour edition tonight. We're going to get more music, and we'll be back in about less than 2 minutes right here. Hairspray at 8, decades every Saturday night on right here on The River 105 and 103.5, theriverNEPA.com, decades with JoeyKramer.com, and the Radio Bold app. Hang on.
This is Hairspray at 8 with Joe E. Kramer. Turn it up. Generation that put a hole in the ozone.
Hairspray at 8 on Decades.
Yes.
105, 103.5. Hairspray at 8. 2 hour edition tonight. Rex Havoc here and Thunder.
Yeah.
Journey Love.
Wasn't that produced by the guy from Duran Duran?
To Andy Taylor?
Yeah.
Yeah. He also had an album called Thunder.
Yeah.
How about that? I wonder if it was $1,000 like the new Guns N' Roses box set.
No, probably not, because it wasn't a box set.
$1,000 gets you the new Appetite for Destruction 30th anniversary box set.
Yeah, I was...
Interviews.
I was looking at that, man. It's pretty decent what you get. I mean, you get a bunch of nice Guns N' Roses swag, but
I don't know. This is in the same category as shaking their hand for $1,500.
I'm sure Axl charges way more than $1,500 to meet him.
Well, I'm just saying. Bands make their money off of, what did I say? Concerts. Looking back, all the people I've talked to, all of them have said the same thing. Even back in the 80s, 70s, whatever, they made very little money off their albums because they'd get these contracts. They'd say, oh, we're going to give you $1 million to record this contract. That $1 million would be spent on everything from recording to videos, and they'd get like 5 cents an album or a single, you know, 20 cents an album. So you'd never, they'd have to go on the road to make that money. So right. Now let's go on the road, make the money, and then say, hey, we want more money from you to shake our hand.
Well, I mean,
I'm going to stand out here and I'm going to have people shake my hand for a quarter.
We probably have better luck if I do.
Just saying. $1,000 for a box set.
Listen, yeah, it's nothing against you. You're a nice guy. But you don't deal well with people.
I don't know.
I think I would be better to be the one out there.
I'd have to sit there and say 25 cents.
For a quarter.
You could shake my hand.
Yeah.
I'll put some makeup on too. Stick my tongue out.
Eyeliner as well, or you know, I mean,
I used to wear some pretty cool eyeliner in the '80s. I'm not ashamed to admit that.
Oh.
I loved my eyeliner.
You've just made me a happy boy. This is one of my all-time favorite songs.
Shotgun Messiah on Hairspray at 8.
I walk the streets alone at night. A shadow in the city light. I didn't know that love could hurt. How little broken hearts are worth.
the door and cut the light. I won't be coming home tonight.
This is Hairspray at 8.
The biggest hits. The river.
Slowly wrap things up here with Rex Havoc in the studio. Here's the best thing I've read tonight. Jack Russell of Great White warns fans online there is an impersonator asking for fishing trip money. That's great. He said he has taken social media to warn fans about an online impersonator. Russell fronts Jack Russell's Great White. From what I understand, there is someone on Instagram posing as me asking people for money to go on a fishing trip.
Okay.
See, what I should do is just charge $10 to, you know, sign something here. Mr. Russell, you got to sign this check in order to cash it. Sorry. You want me to sign that check? You're going to have to pay me $100.
Mr. Russell, can you sign here for this Lotus? Can you sign here for this Lotus Sparkers, please?
That's what they should start doing. Hey, I know we're not, if we're going to charge $1,500 to sign autographs, the banks, they, you know, did they give the banks their autograph?
Oh, wow, man. I'm sure. No.
I'm just asking.
No, I'm willing to bet that they don't even have to cash those. They go right to an accountant.
Probably.
And an accountant, like, you know.
If half them had accountants, they wouldn't be as broke as a lot of them are at this point in their careers.
I didn't say they had good accountants.
No, I guess.
I said they had accountants.
And by the way, the whole Vinnie Vincent thing, there was something posted here in response to the Chris, I hope I'm getting his name right, Seisnack. He basically said, and as D. Matt Porter pointed out to us, Vinny wanted more money. I mean, and they really don't pay people to appear at these things. And, you know, Vinny decided he's trying to make up for 30 years worth of not getting paid. He's still trying to get a cut of all the Kiss stuff. I told you. PBS has recently contacted Vinny Vincent. They're going to have him read stories Saturday morning.
It's you over Denia Doubtfire.
Ew, yes. We're going to talk about Lick It Up today, boys and girls. It'll be quite the programming.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, that's not even nice.
No, it's not. But
should I make fun of Vinny Vincent?
If you can't make fun of Vinny Vincent, who can you make fun of?
I know. That's the truth.
I mean, Eric Carr is dead, so he's off the one. He's off the list. So is Mark St. John. Now, Bruce Kulick is boring, so you're not going to be able to make fun of him.
Let's make fun of Matt Porter.
No.
I'm just kidding, Matt. I was just a joke. That was a joke. Just to make sure if you're listening or not. We'd never do that kind of stuff. Ever.
Yeah.
You could always join the Kiss Room. They just had one on Friday, I think, right? Kiss Room aired on Friday.
I don't know if it's this Friday or this past Friday or next Friday.
He does it once. This past. I saw it on
Podomatic. I can't listen to him at work anyway. So.
But what do they do? Does he do it every once a month or twice a month?
I think it's like twice a month.
But the seventh season of the Kiss Room kicked off, so
yeah,
good show. So there's your plug, Matt.
I want to point out the reason it's called the Kiss Room is he actually has a Kiss Room in his house. I mean, it's crazy.
He broadcasts live from that Kiss Room.
No, he just not.
I know.
He is not. But I am one of the few people in this world who has actually slept in the Kiss Room.
Yeah. Kiss is getting far too personal. We'll wrap things up with that, and Rex Havoc. It was a pleasure, as always.
It's always fun to come here and hang out with you for a while, Joe.
We'll do it again in a couple years. And
probably. Well, I think I'm booked pretty well next month.
Yeah, send me your schedule, and we'll work something out.
And then I know you said something about...
Have your people call my people, and we'll...
And then I know you said something about missing time.
I don't know yet, whenever my jaw's ready, I'm going to have to go...
I'm telling you, she'd let me just come in here and
play. Yeah, that's... Yeah, we'll talk about that, too.
All right.
Okay, yeah, sure. All right, we'll get more. We have more decades coming up. Shalimar, The Cure, Roman Holiday, more... Right here, wrapping up Hairspray at 8. This is Decades on the River 105 and 103.5 around the world at theriverNEPA.com. Decades with Joey Kramer.com, the Radio Bolt app. And now you can say goodbye, Havoc.
Goodbye, Havoc.